worst matchup for KT in this league, well, just because Duke is such a strong laner.
That's right. Well, here we go. Picks and bans for game number one between Dodge and Empire and KT Rolster, Azir and Kalista. The first two bans.
Are they going to ban the Cassiopeia, which Goon played in both games last time, especially since Duke is not going to be playing Ryze? And Najin, it was a bit interesting. We saw them recently kind of get suckered into picking the Ryze and prioritizing it very heavily, and that came back to bite them.
Yeah, they're certainly not going to be first picking it after the losses on that Ryze earlier. There is a Cassiopeia ban. So Goon will have to play something a little bit different, which shouldn't really hurt him too much.
He'll probably just pick Victor. There, of course, is the Gragas ban. Very necessary against Watch. Do you take Rek'Sai here? Do you take
Sivir, Alistar?
I mean, Watch likes to play Evelynn. I think Alistar probably... Alistar or Sivir, you'd have to think, are going to be the choice. I'd take Sivir just because you're against KT.
But I would take Alistar.
They're going to take Alistar.
I feel like Sivir is such a waste on OQ, you know? Put him on something that can make plays. You
yeah,
know?
But KT is so crippled without Sivir that...
That's a good point. Yeah. I suppose. Well, getting the Alistar is nice, too. I'd imagine this is going to be Renekt and Sivir here. And Watch will probably pick up the Evelynn then in that case.
I hope it's not Renekton.
I don't think they're going to pick that one early.
No, I think they're going to take the Victor away.
Oh,
I think
okay.
Victor Sivir here is going to be a pretty attractive... draft.
Now, I mean, Edge has been playing mostly Victor, but he's also been mostly losing on Victor as well. So, how strong of a pick really is this for KT? It seems like it's more of a takeaway from Goon.
You know, and the big difference that I saw in Score's play style between when Edge has been playing and when Nagne has been playing is that Nagne typically doesn't get very many ganks. Score doesn't really focus on the mid lane. Nagne is a very safe player. He just kind of does his thing, farms up, that's whatever. But when Score has been playing with Edge, he ganks the mid lane a lot more. And I feel like he's kind of babysitting Edge to a certain degree. And that's taking his focus away from getting someday ahead, which is typically how the KT Rolster organization actually wins games.
That's a good point. If you put him on a champion like Victor, though, where he can stay back a little bit, farm a bit safer, maybe that will free up Score to pay a little bit more attention to the top lane. Now, will we see Duke? Okay, looks like it might be Rumble Rek'Sai, and it will be locked in. And I don't really feel like Watch having to play Rek'Sai instead of Eve really hurts Najin too much.
Well, I mean, he's not the best Rek'Sai player. Definitely prefers Evelynn when he can get it, but at least he has the Rek'Sai. He's got the Tremor Sense on the Eve, so Score picked into this matchup very deliberately. And there is the Gnar.
All right, and the Janna for Peekaboo as well, too. Peekaboo, of course, spending a lot of time with Wolf on SKT, who is a great roaming Janna player, no doubt, partially because of Peekaboo's advice.
Now, you have to imagine that KT is going to round out their roster with a Poke AD carry, possibly a Corki if they can get it. OQ may just snag that away. And are they going to play the Kassadin into the Victor? Always a champion that Goon is comfortable in, and it will be.
Okay. How do you feel like about that matchup?
I think it's fine. I think that you still lack a little bit of wave clear on Najin's side, so they have to be very cautious about how they approach this. If I'm KT right now, I think Lucian is a very strong pick so that you can abuse the Corki in lane and then get his tower down and start pressuring mid as soon as you possibly can.
Yeah, oh boy. I feel like he's going to switch this over to Vayne, but we'll see. Although Sivir is still available.
A lane bully is a really good opportunity here. Actually, the Draven is not a bad choice. You know, we don't see it very often. It requires snowballing, but he's got a lot of peel with that Janna, and he can do a lot of damage in a 2v2.
Now 10 seconds left. Is he going to lock it in?
Oh.
Kog'Maw, okay.
Yep, but that's another long-range AD carry where you can actually just siege. So he'll be able to win the matchup early on as well. We did see a Kog'Maw in last night's games. Fury did very well on it. And Kog'Maw Janna is a difficult lane for a Corki because you get poked out so easily by the Bioarcane Barrage. It's exactly what we saw Samsung doing yesterday.
Yeah. Now, I wonder, though, how vulnerable do you think they are to just getting jumped on, too? You know, if Peekaboo uses that Whirlwind, doesn't hit anybody with it, Pyr can respond by just diving in onto Arrow, potentially.
Yeah, I mean, you have the Monsoon, that as soon as you hit level 6 to disengage from the Alistar. But you know, there's not a ton of peel here, clearly, with the Evelyn on the jungle, who's going to need to engage with someday's follow-up on the Gnar, but they have a lot of damage threats for the late game. Najin, of course, going to be looking to get into that backline. They have the Equalizer, and that's the Equalizer is very good against Viktor and Kog'Maw, who have no way to get off of it quickly. They just have to run.
Yeah.
So you're guaranteed to take some damage right there.
Well, we'll see what happens. I mean, Najin beat KT so thoroughly, lane by lane last time, that you really think that KT is going to need to come with something just much better across the board to try to even make a dent against Najin.
Yeah.
That's a lot to ask for after only 5 days.
Especially with Edge, who's still so new.
Yeah. Well, it is time, guys. Game number one, Najin Empire versus KT Rollster. Let's get in the game and see who takes it. Welcome to Summoner's Rift, Najin Empire versus KT Rollster. Cassidy kind of has like a jolly bob as he walks through the jungle. He's kind of floating slash walking. It looks like he's kind of moving his legs, though, underneath his robe,
he just
skirt,
likes to,
whatever you want to call it.
He just likes to groove while he floats, you know?
if you're floating, would you still like move your legs like you're walking? Just to confuse people.
It looks like you would get seasick, just floating like that, constantly bobbing up and down.
I know, right?
And you can't throw up in that mask, dude. It makes a mess.
Oh, dude, yeah, like it's stuck in the tubes and all that. That takes forever to watch out. Man, maybe just take some Dramamine before every match, you know?
Before he moves anywhere.
That's true.
In the world.
He could just walk normally. Might just be showing off, you know? Some fans happy the Pickaboo is back. Back for his old team's rival team, interestingly enough.
He's a telecom trader, Doha.
That's right. He would like to change his long-distance service.
All right, so deep wards in. We are going to see the lanes. KT really wanted to get this 2v2. You can see they detect the dual lane onto the ward, immediately heading down to the bottom side of the map. Interesting invade here. Now they know that nobody from Najin is in the bottom side jungle due to that ward placement. We're seeing that configuration of wards more frequently these days. So it will be just a buff steal. Cute little move.
Yeah, we'll see if that leads to three buff for KT early on. It could. Yeah, do you think they'll move right over to the other red?
We'll see what they do. It looks like they just want to go for the Raptors right now, but there's definitely an opportunity for Najin to go ahead and take the enemy red. They're pinging it right now. They don't necessarily know what's going on, but they should strongly suspect.
Somebody really wants this Raptor. They'll barely get it.
That
is. Man, if Goong only knew. If Goong knew he was down there, he could just go and breathe on him. Get first blood.
That is a little risky.
I know. What if somebody comes through the brush right by the Raptor bit?
I don't agree with that. That is, like, needlessly risky right there.
Someday likes to live dangerously.
He definitely does like to live dangerously. I cannot argue with that.
Change his name to Some Danger.
Some Danger Day.
Some Danger. Danger Day.
That's his middle name.
Some Danger Day. Put danger in quotes in the middle. Come score for an early gank in bot lane. He's going to try to put some damage in onto these guys.
Yep, not going to show though, so they
nope.
Have no idea that Evelyn was even there. Najin not playing aggressively enough to really justify that, and they won't either. I mean, Arrow's just going to have a pretty easy time on this Kog'Maw. Poking them out. You can see there's not really any possible response there for MoQ.
Yeah, Pickaboo doing a good job of really aggressively auto-attacking as well. Getting that gold with the Spell Thief's Edge.
Got to make the money from,
oh, that's right,
from hitting cows.
Yep. Many do.
Really? Many do?
I think so.
Hitting cows is animal abuse, Noah.
Well, you humanely hit them, and then you humanely cut them into steaks, and I humanely eat them. Works out pretty well. Humanely. We'll see what happens in this mid lane with Goong and Edge. Edge is pushed up pretty far. And without a lot of wards to protect him, that could end up being a little bit risky, but Watch isn't exactly the most aggressive ganker ever, so given the matchup, he may not have to be too worried.
Yeah, he's not doing a lot, though, in terms of getting deep wards in or really seeing what's going on with the KT team. He's had some opportunities. Of course, KT playing a bit fast and loose.
Why not?
Carry rating. It's by the way, that is damage plus damage dealt plus damage received divided by the number of minutes in a game for top laners.
Ray Math.
I know it's your favorite, Doa.
I love it.
One of your greatest skills.
Man, do I love math. My favorite character in Jurassic Park, Ian Malcolm, by far. Because I love math.
And you love chaos. I know you love chaos.
Life finds a way. You know?
So he saw score right there in the jungle with the Tremor Sense. Just going to pop a ward down. So you know exactly where Evelynn is as he clears out the Krugs. And that's going to be just about it for the moment. Goong doing absolutely fine in this lane. Still has a ton of pots. I mean, Edge has really put zero pressure onto this Kassadin so far. Full HP, and Goong couldn't be happier right now.
Oh, nice. Oh, I thought he denied it. Hit him with the auto, but it wasn't quite quick enough. Well, score coming in now. A little bit of pressure onto Goong, see if they can do some damage there. Goong just going to turn with the slow. Edge misses his death laser. Aw.
The death ray.
Death
so
ray.
Sad. So sad. But not really a very effective gank there from Score, and not a whole lot of kill pressure with zero crowd control coming into the Kassadin. Goong doesn't have to burn flash. He doesn't even have Rift Walk to get out of that, and that was a pretty sad gank.
Yeah, well, that's called a pre-6 Evelynn gank, man.
Well, I mean, he has a choice here.
Oh, Pure getting caught. There's the exhaust, knock up on the score. They're going to try to make a play here. Pure has the flash. He's already so low, though. That is certainly going to be first blood, and it goes over to Edge, grabbing that one with the Chaos Storm.
Yep, very punishing. Pure goes up, tries to get into the jungle. Now Duke just going to clear out the wave right now with the Equalizer. Uh-oh.
Oh, Someday going in. Wow, he's so low. Ultimate gets wall, about to go to Meganar, and Someday may be able to get the 1v1 here. Duke on the run, and there's the Q from Someday to finish him off. A great solo kill, and some representatives from KT here. That's actually the executive vice president of the baseball team.
Yeah, it does. Works with a lot of the sports teams, and of course the esports team operated by KT. So yeah, Duke right there. I don't know what Duke was thinking. Someday was about to go Meganar, and he dropped that Equalizer.
Yeah.
So kind of got what he deserved in that situation, honestly, because if we take a look at this, drops the Equalizer, starts to just clear out the wave. Duke is not expecting an all-in, but Someday sees that he's about to go Meganar. He sees Duke is overheated. He's like, screw it, I'm going.
Yeah.
Gets the HP from the Meganar form, and then really easy cleanup. So strangely sloppy play, but Someday taking advantage of the situation as it's presented to him.
Really not a lot to be worried about in that situation if you're Someday.
And most of the time, this Gnar Rumble matchup hinges on when Gnar gets the Hex Drinker. Gnar is not very strong before he gets a little more damage and a little more MR in this matchup. And once he gets that item, that's when it really starts to go in favor of Gnar. But he's going to get that kill before he even had a Hex Drinker. Go back, pick it up. So I'd imagine this isn't going to go too well for Duke.
Yeah, it's looking a little bit rough. He's got his Haunting guys, but again, that's not going to matter a whole lot. If Someday wants to keep the pressure on. Goong just popping over the wall to take that blue buff. And so, aside from a couple early kills for KT, things pretty passive, but already some things that Najin needs to be a bit worried about.
Yeah, I mean, Najin has a decent mid game here. They have a pretty smooth power curve with the Corki and Rumble into the late game Kassadin. Bit worried that MR will be overly effective on them, considering that they do have the Corki alongside double AP. But Goong's a very good Kassadin player, and KT has two low mobility carries in Victor and Kog'Maw. And considering that they're top of jungle.
Here comes Score, trying to catch Watch here. Can he do anything? Maybe steal this red buff. Edge thought about coming down, turned around because Goong followed. I think the red buff was taken. Yeah, it was taken by Score, it looks like.
Yeah, and this is good play from Score. Notice that they keep invading the mid lane because Najin doesn't have any pressure. And Najin's kind of misplaying around this right now. They've allowed the wards to get deep into their own jungle. Pure was trying to get wards across the river when they have a Kassadin in the mid lane. They cannot play this way with how much pressure Edge is putting on right now.
In the meantime, Peekaboo's been able to help Arrow stay relevant, if not ahead in CS anyway. Poking pretty well.
Yeah, and Watch just hasn't been able to find any ganks so far. He hasn't even tried, just been farming this entire time.
Yeah. And you gotta wonder if that Evelynn pick was really a big takeaway after all. I mean, Watch has played mostly Eve this season. A little bit of the other junglers, but that's about it. He may come in now. We'll see.
Pure is six. They really want to dive this with the cast in. Definitely a good plan. They know Peekaboo's there in the brush now. They're going to back off, however. Huh. It's a bit of a surprise. I think they definitely could have made a play right there with Goom.
Well, yeah, with no Peekaboo there, you'd think it would have been pretty easy to actually get in and take out this Kog'Maw quickly.
They could also just do Dragon right now. There was the recall from Peekaboo, and then Victor no longer in lane, so they had every opportunity to do a three-man dragon right there.
And they had wards, too, so they would have been able to see if anyone was coming in.
Bit of a strange call.
Yeah. Well, Najin's certainly looking a little bit apprehensive at the beginning of this game. They look a bit scared.
Yeah, I think they're just worried about the deep wards in their own jungle, and so they don't want to be the first team to really commit to anything. Also, OQ hasn't backed yet at 11 minutes into this game.
Yeah, that's I suppose Arrow hasn't either.
That would have been a very slow dragon. Never mind. So, would have been risky.
Maybe that's part of the idea not to dive Arrow too as well.
Yeah, definitely, probably a contributing factor. Pure.
I mean, then again, Arrow hadn't backed either, so he would have been pretty vulnerable.
Well, yeah, but the problem is that if Arrow backs, he may not get more HP or anything like that, so he's always pretty much going to be as squishy as he is now. Maybe he gets a phage or something, but
could be.
The real thing is how fast can you kill Arrow, and with zero items, the answer is not very fast.
And that leads us to a pretty passive early mid-game here, I suppose.
Someday's getting his lead, and he's that carry force on this KT team, and OQ, just not that same kind of advantage yet. Have to see if he can get a big edge that will allow him to carry. OQ actually going for Blade first.
Wow. That's something we almost never see. Strange, and I mean, do you think it was maybe just to grab a power spike right before the dragon? Because if it was, he's going to be disappointed that the dragon's already gone.
I don't know why he would get that item right now. Maybe he just had enough gold for it, but that is a bit weird. I think he must, the logic behind this, he must be very worried about getting poked out by Arrow, and he wants the sustain. And also, Someday is ahead and is going to be building tank stats, but doesn't have any armor yet. He's been stacking MR. So this actually makes him much more of a threat to Someday, but I mean, it's not...
Well, they're not lane swapping or anything.
Right.
Interesting.
Curious.
Yeah, they're going to see that the dragon's gone, too. I mean, right when that weak recall happened, KT went back and took it pretty easily.
There is a lot of MR stacking on KT, so that could... He just may want to just maximize his attack damage at the moment, but, of course, he's going to do a ton of attack damage with Trinity Force, too. So that is a bit of a head-scratch. We'll see how he uses it.
Yeah, OQ playing the dueling playmaking Corki. That's the answer.
Split push Corki.
Hey, if anyone would do it, it would be OQ.
That is true. The split push Corki, very interesting. I'm looking forward to seeing how this build develops.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose it does help him go toe-to-toe with Arrow better. Helps him sustain off those minions if he takes damage. Does make sense in that regard.
Yep, and the invades begin. Onto the blue buff. Someday just using the Gnar bar and the rage timer. Take that away. That's a very good takeaway for KT. They're playing around this Kassadin really well so far. Not only in terms of warding and scores invades, there's the buff steals because the lack of pressure in the mid lane and the fact that this Kassadin needs a long time just to ramp up. as the Rod of Age is.
And Duke wasn't really able to do a lot of damage to the turret or anything like that in return.
Oh, well, no. I mean, he's getting pushed around right now by Someday's Gnar. He fell behind in lane, and that gap is getting bigger and bigger and bigger. It was then, you know, started 20 CS a few minutes ago, now up to over 30.
Yeah, CS lead growing a little bit for OQ, too.
So that turret getting pretty low. Same thing in the top side. I mean, Najin has to make a move soon, at least to try and skirmish maybe with the top laner. I think the best thing Najin can do is try and get a gank onto the bottom side and try and dive this turret with the Alistar and have Someday teleport down. That would probably be a nice play for them to go for. Then they can just trade turret for turret in the end if they can lock down Arrow. The Monsoon now is up. That will make things a little bit more difficult.
Yeah, Score throws a ward right in front of Cure as well, too. OQ having to Valkyrie away from that one. Score and watch right there. They've got to turn the Tri-Brush, so KT knows where Najin is right now. Yeah, Edge is going to be able to get this turret pretty soon, it looks like. Oh, Goon going in onto Edge a little bit, but he's going to turn around. Needs to be careful there. Goon does have Ignite. Edge has Barrier, though.
Yeah, and they can't stop or punish Score for doing this at all. Score's just able to walk up and get a pink ward right there. Watch going to scrap with him, but Peekaboo on the other side.
Oh, Score going in, starting to lay down the damage onto Watch now, and Watch has to flee. Pure coming up to try to help, but it's a little bit too late.
Najin doesn't seem to understand that they do not have control over their jungle right now. They can't just keep doing that because they lose HP, and now there's no defense on the turret.
Yeah, Duke really low up in top lane as well, too, and Someday able to get that turret down to less than half health.
Yeah, and he had to drop Equalizer, which means that he's probably going to have to TP back as well into the top lane. So Someday may just end up with a free TP advantage when the dust settles, and looks like, nope, Duke not going to TP, but that may cost him a tower.
You know, I guess with Dragon coming up in a minute 42, he wants to try to save it for that, but I don't know if it'd be worth trading that first Dragon for Najin for the tower. It looks like they're going to lose it anyway, so it's not even going to be a trade.
Yeah, it's definitely not going to be a trade. Duke just backs off of that one, and all of a sudden, mostly due to Najin just falling behind in the laning phase, KT up a pretty significant amount of gold, nearly 4,000. That is very large for almost no action in this game. Two towers really adding to that total.
Well, this has just been a weird game, you know? Najin just seems unwilling to do anything.
Yeah, and I don't understand what's going on with the Blade of the Ruined King. They're, like I said, they're not respecting KT's mid lane control, and so we've had a first blood happen as a result of that. And Score's been playing well. He's been playing this matchup right. I mean, he's got deep wards in both sides of the jungle. This is going really, really well for KT. They saw the Kassadin pick, and they have punished it super hard.
Yeah, pretty much. And so how do you come back if you're not? You just look for those picks? You just try to fight around Dragon?
You better hope this Kassadin gets really strong in the late game so that you can punish Victor and the Kog'Maw picks. But Kassadin takes so long to ramp up right now that it's really difficult.
Yeah, Najin needs to channel their inner Najin shield and make the game last like 60 minutes or something.
Definitely could be a way to win.
Please don't do that, Najin.
But by that time, KT's going to have even more magic resistance, which is going to help out significant amounts against Najin's composition.
Dragon's back up. Pure got poked out a little bit. But KT overall looking in pretty good position to take this one. OQ maybe in a little bit of trouble, taking damage from Arrow. He's just going to duel him. Arrow going ahead and moving in. He's still got that Summoner heal too. Looks like OQ will be able to get out. Yeah, that was close. Peekaboo and Score were coming down.
Both flashes used right there. So OQ trying to duel with that Blade of the Ruined King. He just wants the 1v1 early with Arrow. Doesn't actually succeed in getting it completed though due to other people showing up.
Oh, speaking of people showing up, Pure getting caught in the Tri-Brush right now. There's a knock-up from Peekaboo. Teleport coming in, though, and KT backs away. Backs to their own teleport. Goon coming in the side as well, too. This might be Najin's moment. Oh, never mind. Evelyn comes in. Huge Gnar ultimate from Someday, and Arrow just putting tons and tons of damage down. double kill for Edge as well with that Chaos Arm, with everything coming out of Victor. And there's a heal to keep Peekaboo and the rest of KT alive under that turret. They're going to take Bot Turret. They're going to take Dragon. They got four kills. What a huge moment for KT in this game.
And that is just poor communication from Naja. Not to know that Someday is in Mega Gnar form and is going to be teleporting into that team fight, because Someday just shows up, doesn't even have to spend any time transforming, just flashes and ults three of them into a wall. I mean,
yeah.
You have to make sure your team isn't fighting when this happens. What is this? This should not happen.
This is your team on Gnar. Any questions?
Well, just stun locked right there and then absolutely brutalized by a Chaos Storm Death Ray combo. And that's it. It's just so easy. And now KT with a huge, huge lead.
And Peekaboo with the flash whirlwind at the end there to secure that last kill. I like it. He's always been bloodthirsty. Oh, Someday finds Watch in the jungle there. It's a knockup. Someday gets a stun, and here comes Goong to try to claim this blue buff anyway. Doing the damage onto Someday. Watch gets very low. Someday takes him out. Now it's a 2v2. Peekaboo coming in to help. Can he keep his top alive? Doesn't look like it. Edge and Score coming in. Maybe they can turn this around.
Well, it's Kassadin, so he's going to get out. But
looks that way.
Someday, a little greedy right there.
Maybe a bit.
Goes a in. Bit. Does take out Watch, and he's got a Maw of Malmortius finished already. Just going for the carry build here Someday.
I like it. I like it, man. I mean, this is what we talked about. They need Someday to carry if they're going to win these games. This is the person that KT depends on to do the damage to make the plays.
Well, it's also a great split push item, but
yeah,
OQ is really, really dangerous with this Blade of the Ruined King. He keeps using it to all in arrow. I love it.
Yeah. That's a good way to handle this Kog'Maw early before some of those early items are done. Now that the Trinity Force, now that the Cutlass is finished for Arrow, though, might be a little bit more tough, although that last fight still went OQ's way. Here comes Score. Watch is behind him, though. Yeah, Watch is going to find him. Go right in on the Score. Here comes OQ Valkyrieing ahead. He's like, oh, I should have saved it to go over the wall.
I know that's what OQ is. I needed to angle it diagonally instead.
Yep, that's
what
right.
What was I thinking?
He wants to dive in so bad.
I just imagine Zeffa standing behind him saying, like, no OQ.
That's right. I imagine, like, the specter of Mach Noon appearing like Obi-Wan Kenobi and just saying, do dive.
Do the dive, OQ.
Do the dive, OQ. Trust your feelings. No one is on the other side of that wall. Oh, wait, there was the whole team. Sorry about that.
Aren't you supposed to be able to use the Force to detect things that you can't normally see?
No, you depend on Obi-Wan for that. He just tells you this stuff, you know? This is a winning lottery ticket.
Wow, this Kassadin has caused Najin so many problems.
Now, KT is just dismantling Najin 2 all across the board. This is like the direct opposite of what we saw less than a week ago. Maybe 5 days can change a lot.
Well, KT is just running a clinic on how to deal with Kassadin. Is really it. I mean, I don't think Kassadin is a very good pick right now for this reason. Score on the Evelynn has just been able to get into the enemy jungle. They've had more. How do you get deep wards into both sides of the enemy jungle? What is your sorcery score that you're actually able to do this? Because that should not be possible. But that's one of the things that is enabled by the Kassadin pick if Edge plays aggressively in the lane. And Watch has just been seen in his own jungle this entire. He's getting chased around by a wolf spirit right now. I mean, there's nowhere for him to go where he doesn't get seen by KT.
Pretty much. Najin trying to get some semblance of vision back, but there's not a lot they can do. I mean, Arrow's getting some farm, but he's just not where they need him to be yet. He still doesn't have that Blade of the Ruined King. No, actually, that's okay. I've got Someday. They don't need Arrow to do damage.
Exactly.
They've got Edge as well.
They actually don't really need Arrow on a Kog'Maw this game.
They need OQ to get that Trinity Force. That's what Najin needs.
Yeah, well, OQ got it.
He got it. All right, there.
It's completed now, so at least they'll have that for the next dragon, especially as Goon also hits his second core item.
Well, feel like KT can just kind of wait out for this dragon and see if Najin wants to lose another team fight.
I mean, they are definitely in every possible condition to go ahead and win this game and take all the dragons and really snowball off that objective. Najin has to do something pretty drastic to turn their fortune around.
They're 9,000 gold down right now. They found Watch again. Whirlwind doesn't connect, so they don't get the knockup. But the lead that KT has means they can just fight this if they want to. Oh, Boom finds Score. That's a little bit of damage. Dragon up in less than a minute, though, so KT not wanting to commit to anything too crazy as far as chases go.
Yeah, they don't have to. Just get the wards in. KT playing this game out very methodically. And then take the... Oh, here we go.
Oh wow. Nice. Headbutt, pulverize. Pikaboo and Score. Pikaboo goes down. All pushes away the rest of Najin. That gives KT time to catch up. Nice equalizer, though. Wow. Flash is used by KT. Score getting very low. There's a flash. Goon picks up one kill. He's still low health. Goes down. And OQ can't really make the difference. Someday tried to come in from behind with the teleport. Didn't really find a target, though.
Someday canceled his teleport.
Oh, he did.
So he never even arrived at that fight. So once Duke got there, it was just really easy for them to drop the equalizer and go in. Now, they didn't get that much of an advantage out of that situation, Najin. I mean, it was a small skirmish, but they didn't actually take any objective, and they're still massively behind in this game. So it doesn't really matter that KT lost that fight, but still a mistake from Someday.
Now, that was really just a nice play from Pure to set up a kill or two. More than anything. And so KT, not too worried about taking that dragon right now. They can just kind of wait for everybody to get back before they do it.
Yep. Well, they should because their jungler isn't there. So need him to get back and get the smite, and then they will be able to take that objective Someday. Just sitting there in Meganar form. He's going to be a while before he can actually fight again. They're going to start the dragon anyway.
Yeah, I suppose they can. I mean, Najin not really threatening them anywhere. So why not? Third dragon goes over to KT Rolster. Third in a row now.
Yeah, making it look easy this game. Much more precision than we saw out of KT just 5 days ago. And Najin just, they played so aggressively in their last game, but taking away that Cassiopeia from Goong has kind of caused the team to fall apart because they don't have the strong presence in the middle of the map to control vision.
It's just bizarre, you know, seeing how completely Najin has been picked apart this game.
Well, that's what Kassadin does, you know, and it's why he's a very exploitable champion right now.
Well, I think banning the Cassiopeia, taking away the Victor were very smart decisions for KT. And I wonder what you do when you're Najin next game. If you still try to go for one of these two picks, or if you go back to an assassin, perhaps.
Right, and remember that KT will be on the blue side next game, so they will definitely have the freedom to continue banning Cassiopeia.
Yeah.
If they want to.
And first picking Victor away, even if they want to. No, we'll see that, but they could.
And, you know, the funny thing, too, is Goon could have picked Ahri here. Absolutely. Into Victor.
Yeah.
He could have picked Zed. He loves playing Zed into Victor.
That's what I was kind of wondering, too. I mean, I feel like if Victor and Cassiopeia are both out of the way, you know, don't you go for one of those default Goon assassin characters?
That's what I would think. That's what I would suspect.
Well, apparently, we're both wrong. Swing for Cass. Oh, here we go. KT trying to make a plan to Duke. There's the slow. He flashes out of the whirlwind. He gets away. They got the flash, though, so a win for KT.
And Someday split push. Just going to keep on marching forward, finally getting some armor. So he can deal with OQ. He's going to hide.
I don't know if that works Someday. You're kind of big.
I like how he just hides there. He's like, I wonder if OQ is going to walk in here.
He might. It's an OQ thing to do.
Yeah, he was just seeing if somebody was going to farm the wave so he could chase them down, but not actually going to fool anyone right there.
Yeah, KT continuing to take control of the enemy jungle, too.
Yeah, they've done a great job with their vision this game. That has been on point from KT Rolster.
Oh, this might be a turret. We'll see if KT can defend it. Tokyu doing a lot of damage to it, but he's going to have to pull back. KT's just got too much power right now. Oh.
Yeah, Duke simply can't deal with this matchup. It's been going south for him ever since that solo kill early on, and now that he's fallen behind in terms of itemization. Yeah, he's got the Void Staff now, but he doesn't really have a lot of damage to back it up.
So it doesn't take a lot. TP advantage for KT right now as well. Dukes is still down for a little bit. There's the teleport for Someday. Just wants to make sure they can secure this Baron. Baron at about half health right now. Najin wants to try to contest this. Watch throwing in that Prey Seeker. Here comes Goong. A lot of damage on the Pickaboo. He goes down anyway. Goong with the kill there. Baron taken by Najin, though. Baron taken by KT, rather. Najin trying to turn things around, but Edge does a little bit too much damage. Another ult from Someday brings Pure in for KT to pick apart. Goong on the run gets taken down, though, by Arrow. Duke a little bit late to the party. A lot late to the party. And there's nothing he can really do, so... Well, KT, they lose Pickaboo, but they do take the Baron.
Now, Someday knew that Equalizer was down because it was just used bottom to clear out the wave, so that gave them actually a very preferential team fight around that Baron, considering that Someday had his ultimate still available to him. So, Najin really struggling to do much of anything this game. Arrow doesn't have any mana. And back off right there. KT doesn't want to commit too much. Might as well just go spend that gold, get some more items, and then you'll be able to pressure more on the other side. They want to push the waves out first, though. Quite understandable.
Yeah, might as well. Need a little bit of protection while you go back. And that fourth dragon coming up in a minute 30 as well, too. So KT's going to have that Baron buff. They're going to have the lanes pushed while they can pressure dragon at the same time.
Oh, it's man. Pretty good. Pickaboo lost a bunch of stacks of his Magi's that he got very early into this game because he sacrificed himself for the team getting Baron.
Pickaboo is one of my favorite supports, man. Who's gone for a while, you know, for months, joins a new team, first game back, just picks up Magi's. It's like, all right, yeah.
It's a good item on Janna because you rarely die if you play her properly.
It's true.
Unless you are throwing your body in the way of the enemy team so that your jungler can successfully smite the Baron.
Huh. Yeah, that happens sometimes. Well, good amount of MR as well for KT across the board.
KT can definitely siege harder with this composition. They should just start 4-1 splitting with this Gnar and actually use the Baron buff. Yes, they're worried about the dragon. Yeah, they want number 4 so they can threaten number 5, but, you know, they haven't done a whole lot with the Baron buff yet, even though they definitely can.
Well, just
the wave clear is so poor from Najin. All they have is Corki Rockets and an Equalizer.
It just looks like KT is just not used to being in this position right now, you know? Not used to being so far ahead. Go for that dragon, and it looks unlikely that Najin's going to try to contest this.
No, they really can't. They have to let him have number 4, and at the very least, buy some time off that Baron buff. And Oki just going to farm out the top side at the moment. They want to push these waves as far back as possible while they know that KT is doing the dragon.
Unfortunately for them, bottom lane isn't going to be like that. Arrow's been pushing it the entire time, and now the rest of KT coming down to try to take out the turret farthest from Baron. Yeah, they're going to burn through these pretty quick now.
Yeah, they are. Someday actually going to rotate into the bottom side of the map. That is a bit of a surprise. Could have just waited for that one in mid, but I guess he wants to zone him out with his Meganar form right now. Play a little bit backwards.
Oh,
there's
equalizer.
The Equalizer
goes down. Score a little bit trapped. Arrow manages to get off of it. No follow-up for Najin. And so KT's fine. That turret is nearly dead, too. Oh, Pickaboo gets caught and takes a little bit of damage, but not a lot. Not yet. There goes the inhibitor turret. And KT coming in now. Score gets a little bit low. OQ backing away, dealing the damage with the rockets, but Edge following up with a death ray.
Yeah, they have to be really scared of this Kassadin right now, especially with Score as low as he is. Fortunately, he's invisible.
Yeah, that does help. And inhibitor taken pretty much like a piece of cake for KT.
Taken like a piece of cake.
Yep, just like you know, pick up a piece of cake and
just take
eat
it.
Eat it.
Just take
it. I don't know. Mixing my metaphors.
Do a confirmed cake thief.
And make like a Maokai and leave. Yep. I don't think you're going to do a lot of damage to Sunday. Well, slow, methodical pause.
That's
and
what
a slow, methodical end of this game is.
That's what we need, a pause right now.
That's right. I didn't think the game was long enough yet, you know?
Watch as gank button was broken that game.
I
couldn't gank.
That's right. My gank button doesn't work. Oh, well. When he was a young jungler, he wanted to take some cake, so they got him an easy gank oven.
That'd be great.
It's rad. Well, Peekaboo's like, oh, man, did the league get this easy when I was gone? I don't know about that, Peekaboo. Don't assume too much.
Every team with Peekaboo wins.
Yeah, pretty much.
That's what I've learned.
Hey, Peekaboo may not have played in the finals, but he did win it.
He sat there looking quite handsome.
Kind of forlorn at the same time, but also handsome. There you go. And yeah, that dude is the executive vice president for the KT. He specializes in the baseball team, I've been told, but also is involved in other sports.
He dabbles in the esports world. He's come to see the glory of KT someday, carrying out of the top lane.
Ready to drop that baseball thing, whatever that is.
What? That's like it's an old sport, right? I don't know what that is anymore, Doa. I've moved on to the digital world.
You only play digital baseball. I know there's like a Mario baseball game or something like that.
Can I talk about baseball for a minute?
Yeah, go ahead.
That sport sucks.
it's not as dull as soccer, but it's right up there.
I agree with you.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's just, why would you invent a team game where 90% of the action is between two people, the pitcher and the batter, and then only occasionally does other stuff. It's not even a team sport. It's just like a 1v1 with some guys running around a field for like 10 seconds of the game.
You know, sometimes the ball goes to the guys in the field. And
yeah,
they
I know.
Gotta throw it to each other.
I know, but that happens. That doesn't even happen that often.
Well, it depends on how good the pitcher is, right? Yeah, I suppose.
But see, the intention of the game is for that to never happen.
What's the best non-esport in your opinion, then?
What's the best non-esport?
Yeah.
I like American football.
Me too.
I know. We're fans.
We are. We're fans. It's true. I also like badminton, the fastest net sport known to man.
Who's your favorite badminton player, Doa?
I don't know any pro Me,
exposed.
Myself. I am. I didn't say I liked watching badminton. I like playing badminton. You know, I played basketball for most of my grade and high school career.
Were you a baller, Doa?
I was a forward. I was just taller than all the other kids, so they just threw me the ball, and then I just put it in. It's really easy. I didn't really need to move. I was like a baseball player. We're really working on cultivating our hatred from two specific sports today. Baseball and soccer?
Yeah.
We've worked on soccer in the past, though.
I love tweeting about soccer because it makes the Europeans so mad.
Well, it's like, wow. Well, I mean, at least they've got FIFA. Those seem like good fellows, right?
Yeah. Really
salt of the earth, those guys.
Solid guys.
Yeah.
You're welcome, good Europeans, for cleaning up FIFA for you.
That's right.
As now an American, I will personally take responsibility for that.
In return, though, you have to start calling it soccer. We've saved your sport. Now you have to call it what we call it.
I wish that was
it's only fair.
Clause.
It seems very appropriate to me. Duke is nodding. He agrees. He kind of looks like a baseball player. He's not doing anything. He's chewing on something. It's pretty baseball-esque, I think, isn't it?
Sitting there chewing something, waiting
That's
for
right.
something to happen.
Yep. You know the most exciting part of a baseball game is when like the ball flies into the stands and like someone catches it in their glass of beer.
I do like going to baseball games because the glory of baseball games is you can sit there and have a beer and you have to pay attention to the sport once every 5 minutes. It demands almost no attention.
Dude, I gotta say though, one of my most American experiences ever, though, was going to an Oakland A's game on the 4th of July, and like they had like F-16s fly over the beginning, and I had like a chili dog and a beer, and I'm like, wow, this is the most American I've ever been. That was fun.
That says something, because you're from the Midwest. The most American part of America.
Oh, well, thank you.
I don't know if that's a compliment. Anyway.
Depends on how you feel. I'll take it as one. Uh-oh. Watch out, score. Operation get score. But he's invisible. Oh, but they can see him. Oh, but they're not going to do anything. Okay. That was interesting. Oh. What? Why not jump on score right there?
Well, because there was everybody in the top side, and they were going to get ulted and all die.
Thank you. That's why we keep you around. Set analysis.
Oh, KT. Starting to group right now. Turning their...
Oh, hello.
Why is Watch there?
I don't know. Goog is there too, though. Watch gets exhausted, gets taken down. And they're going to ult Goon right into the wall, too. Can they actually catch Cass? A nice play from Peekaboo, actually, just to secure that. No teleports for you, Goon.
No rift walking there. Just stun locked and knocked around until his sorry end, as Najin can't really do much of anything. OQ is on a brutal split push mission right now.
Well, unfortunately,
I mean, it is working.
The entire other team is also on a pushing mission. There's a teleport coming from KT. They just want to end it. With OQ on the other side of the map, they probably can. Equalizer goes down. Pure is there as well, too. But there goes the second Nexus turret. And I guess 30 seconds is all we needed after that pause. The game is over. KT takes a well-played but somewhat puzzling game one.
And at the end of the game, OQ is inexplicably in the middle of the base.
Yep.
I don't know what... Where is he going? He valks in, heals himself, and then stands in turret shooting minions.
I don't know. Well, he was double lifting a bit there, I think.
Yes, he was double lifting a bit right there.
In case of the double lifts there. Well, a good re-debut by Peekaboo here on KT Rollster, able to get a win in his first game. Well, I hope Najin wants to play in game two, because it didn't seem like they really wanted to in game one.
Well, I think they won't be playing Kassadin anymore, which was a lot of the cause of some of those issues. Of course, the losing the 1v1 to KT's most threatening carry from Duke at the top side also not doing them a whole lot of favors, so we'll see if they can bounce back.
Someone so young. But here we go. Pick some hands.
No, he was actually already 17 by the time the rule went into effect.
Oh, well, that makes my joke way less funny. Thanks a lot. Thanks. What a great co-caster you are.
I'm just here to be a buzz.
Thanks a lot, Monty.
And tell you when players are bad, to tell you that baseball is bad, to tell you that soccer is bad. That's
my
point.
I agree with those things. Sure.
That's my function.
Now we know. That's what the Monty bot has been programmed to do. Rumble and Cassiopeia banned out for KT Rollster. Callista Gragas banned out by Najin Empire. So KT understandably not wanting to deal with Goom's Callista. And there's the Maokai ban as well, too.
So what is Duke going to respond with this game? They could save that counter pick for him if necessary. Interestingly, we saw Sivir fall all the way through the draft in the last one.
Yeah, I think that's the first time we've seen that happen this season. Well, it hasn't been picked or banned.
No. But
really?
No. Oh. But it is definitely a rarity these days.
Look at Reach. He's upset. He's like, why can't I just build some carriers and show these guys my pro gaming power?
He's going to build some carriers.
Just needs to put some sneak a pylon behind the booth for KT and build a gateway there. You know, start sending zealots in really early.
Get some sick Reaver drops going in.
Cannon rush them. Reach has all the cool tactics. Unfortunately, none of them work in this game.
What?
Shen first pick. Did that just happen? Wow. Okay.
Needless to say, that was not picked or banned at all in the last game. So the sudden first pick Shen.
That was the first time Shen's actually appeared and surprised people. Wow. I never thought I'd see the day. Shen was a true ninja at that moment. Even Victor, the two pickups for Najin.
It was all a setup to this one.
That's
this
right.
One shining example.
He's literally been training for years for this moment. Wow, Edge immediately locking that Azir, and Score taking the Rek'Sai as well.
Yeah, Najin banning out the Azir in game one, not wanting Edge to have that champion. This time they select the Victor, so they should know that the Azir is coming.
Yeah.
Which also is even more curious because They have the counter pick, and you can play Zed into Azir, and you can play Zed into Victor, and I think that Goong should just play Zed.
Well, it's going to be tough, because they've already picked a Victor.
I know, Doa.
Oh, well.
I know.
It's going to be hard. I think we're going to see more of this Shen-Azir combo, though, you know? With Azir being that aggressive as we see people playing him now. Shyvana locked in. Wow, it's just a shy, unmeta pick tribute game, apparently.
The Shy Pocket Pick Bowl.
I guess so, yeah. Shy Pocket Pick Bowl 2015. I like it.
Look Shyvana how far Alistair managed to fall down. I don't know what's going on in these drafts anymore. Why is Alistair selected in the second round of draft on the red side? I mean, Watch apparently really needs that Evelynn, even though Score is a perfectly fine Rek'Sai player. And the main issue is that Score's going to know where Watch is at all times for that Tremor Sense, and it's even easier for you to get in deep wards when you're Rek'Sai against an Eve.
I don't know.
And that was a major problem for Dajin in the last game.
It's very bizarre. Pikaboo had some great Roaming Thresh play back in the day, and we saw Arrow do just fine on that Kog'Maw in Game 1, and it looks like he's going to go for it again in Game 2. Pikaboo with the Thresh, so what will the final pick be?
Yep.
AD carry.
They really rely on Azir to actually initiate these team fights, though, and that's going to take away... This composition is kind of odd from KT. So they need... To get Shen in, they have to have the Azir go in to actually engage these fights, because they can't really engage with the Rek'Sai, and they can't really engage with the Shen. So, but the problem is, that means that as soon as Azir goes in, Kog'Maw has no peel. No peel. There is no one to peel for the Kog'Maw, except maybe a Thresh Box. And that means that Duke is going to be all over this Kog'Maw.
It's the good luck Kog'Maw composition. Because you just kind of start your team fight and you turn to Kog'Maw and say, good luck.
That's how I feel. I mean, certainly they can counter engage with this composition with the Rek'Sai and the Shen ultimate, but it's not really all that reliable when it comes to engages if you want to protect Kog. Now, KT has good siege here, very good siege, but if they start to fall behind and they have to start fighting Najin at Dragon or at Baron where they need to engage, there are going to be big problems for KT. They have to kite, they have to poke, they have to siege. They're not really cut out to falling behind and being forced to engage. Meanwhile, Najin, a lot more engage options. Evelynn flanks, Shyvana ultimates. You have a lot of room right there for Victor and Vayne to skirmish. I think Najin definitely coming out of this with a better composition. Or more versatile, I should say.
We'll see if it pays off for them. A win here would tie the series and send it to a game 3. And Najin, after winning so handily in the last match, I don't think they want to go out 0-2 in this one.
Well, OQ's on Vayne. Champion he does very well on.
He can make the plays. KT versus Najin, game 2. It's time to get in the game. Alright, here we go again. KT Rolster versus Najin the Empire. And perhaps a bit of an early invade for KT. Or perhaps waiting for the invade from Najin.
I'm scratching my head here thinking why KT didn't want to play Sivir in this composition, because it would have given them better engage, and they also wouldn't have to be as worried, because Sivir with her mobility and her spell shield means that she can do a lot better just in the front line. She really wants to be charging through a team fight as opposed to Kog'Maw. I mean, Arrow is a bit of a sitting duck against Shyvana and Evelynn flanks unless they burn the Azir ultimate pretty inefficiently to clear out the tanks.
Well, that's two games in a row now where Sivir wasn't picked or banned. That is pretty shocking.
Yeah, it is. Definitely not the trend we've seen in the last several weeks of play.
What are Someday and Score doing here? They're waiting for a long time. I sense something cheesy here.
Well,
maybe just going for red buff steal, but
no. What? They're going for the steal again, but they're already defensive wards down for Najin at the red buff. So they know what happened last game, and they're suspecting that the same thing's going to happen again. And they would be right to suspect this.
Yeah, they'll just trade buffs, it looks like.
Yeah, they're reacting well. So already the adaptation seen from level ones. And Arrow and Pikaboo just going to take the small Krug and head to lane. They want that advantage. They want the 2v2 with that big, big poke.
Well, they will go into lane with a little bit of an XP boost because of that. Looks like Duke's just going to teleport and then go back up to top lane. Now where are Score and where's Score going to go after this? Taking the Raptors. Looking at the minimap right now. So how do you think this bot lane's going to go?
Not well for Vayne. I mean, you have the sustain at the very least, but you basically are guaranteed to get poked with the Bioarcane Barrage. Not quite as bad as the Janna poke with the Eye of the Storm, but still going to be, I think, a little bit difficult for OQ. But OQ's pretty good about coming out even in the laning phase with his Vayne.
Yeah. Despite the early Krugs too, Najin was able to take their level 2 just slightly earlier. Descendants onto Pure, a little bit of poke going to come in out of that. OQ immediately goes onto Arrow, prevent any sort of big trades. A good move there.
Not really a big deal. These early levels, you know, Vayne's going to, it's going to start going poorly once the big poke comes in from Arrow's Kog'Maw.
Yeah. Well, I'm looking forward to seeing what OQ can do on this Vayne. That is his main champion. It is the champion that he's made a lot of his big plays on, what he's carried the most games on.
Actually, Duke sees Score right there at the Gromp, so they got some good knowledge. Duke just using this time to go ahead and take a Scuttlecrab. And Duke's really free on this top side of the map. The Shyvana pick into the Shen. You're able to clear the waves of the Burnout much faster than Shen can before he gets the Sunfire Cape. And that means you have a lot of time just to work on the map, roam around.
That being the case, are you a little bit surprised you went for Teleport Flash instead of Smite Teleport?
Yeah, I am, actually.
I was kind of thinking that. I mean, with all that time, you could go back and take the Krugs really easily, make sure you keep control of the Rift Sculler.
Also, just would have been great onto Kog'Maw.
Yeah.
Sure. Getting the Smite down onto that Kog'Maw is pretty damaging.
Yeah, in fact, this is one of the first non-Smite Shyvana we've seen, because Shy prefers it with Smite. Nope, Watch taking some damage. Edge coming down too. It's a little bit low health though. They need to be careful here. Yeah. Well, Goong with not a lot of mana left, so the chase would not have been too effective.
Yeah, Najin's still in the enemy jungle though, looking for Score, just getting some wards in as much as they can. Duke then going to respond just by coming in and starting to proxy farm. This is so dangerous against Shen. And this is one of the big problems with Shen, is that you can do this as a top laner, and by getting the deep wards in, by Pure and Watch teaming up to do that, they're opening up Duke to just keep doing this on the top side of the map as long as he knows where the Rek'Sai is. This is really nice team play from Najin. It looks like they definitely got it together after the last game. Just the coordination. Use the wards on the bottom side of the map. Chase Score around his own jungle. Make sure you keep him under control. And then you just screw up someday Shen in the top side.
Well, they're definitely doing that. Duke's making it very hard for him to farm, to not take damage on the turret. Missing out on a little bit of CS there. Someday's not doing a terrible job, but it's not easy.
Somebody's coming back right now. Duke just farming another wave with Burnout. Oh, nice sidestep on the taunt.
Yeah.
That's just annoying.
Yep.
Duke is level 6, so he has his ultimate available, and he's taken the Wolves. He's going to take the Gromp.
Just makes you wonder, too. I mean, Smite would have made a lot of this easier to do, wouldn't it have?
Yeah. Yeah, smart. Just use Burnout. Get out as he sees the Wolf Spear come up. He's too low to deal with it. And the wave is naturally going to push out towards his tower anyway. So nice play from Duke. Gets a little bit of chip damage on the tower, controls someday in that top side, even though he didn't get too much of a CS advantage as a result, but he denied a lot.
And meanwhile, down in bot lane, OQ and Pure have managed to actually poke out Peekaboo and Arrow and do a lot of damage. Look at that. Man, OQ is so good on this Vayne. Because this is not a matchup where you usually see the Vayne Alistar being the duo that's pushing.
Oh boy. It's Blade of the Ruined King, split push Shyvana. This is very exciting. This is a build we haven't seen in a really long time.
Yeah. Well, that would explain the no. I mean, I think we knew kind of because there was no Smite, that was probably the direction it was going to go. But still, it's something we haven't seen in a while.
Could have just gone full tank. Definitely could have been Sunfire Cape.
You gain more by the ability to just jump in and blow up their carry, though, right?
Well, you have to still be tanky, so it does take some time to build into that. But in the dragon form, the extra tanky stats that you get really help out.
Shen doesn't offer a lot of damage early on, too, that you need to worry about.
Watch just a flash.
Yeah, and there's a flash knockup coming in from Score. Watch could be in trouble. Edge comes down, and Watch is going to get taken out. First blood taken with that Emperor's Divide by Edge. Edge getting shielded nicely by that Shen ultimate. Keeps him nice and healthy, and Goon can't pick up a counter kill.
Yeah, but Najin also just going to do even more proxy farming in this top side. Of course, with that sustain off of the Cutlass, that means that basically Duke is not really going to take any damage from the minion waves now that he is tanking with his face.
Yeah.
And Shyvana can take down turrets very quickly. And that's what she's going to get. So they actually trade that for a turret. So in the end, Najin actually gets the better end of that deal.
Getting that top lane turret is huge. Duke's even more safe to do
Duke
all
things.
This farming, to do Duke things.
This is such a good top lane matchup.
Yeah.
Very exciting to watch. It's fun to watch in the first game with that solo kill, and it's been played out very, very intriguingly in the second game, and someday using that ultimate was really punished hard by Duke, as well as it should have been. And
well, it's fun.
He's just going to keep trying to be the big carry on his team.
It's nice when you have two, you know, mechanically skilled, talented top laners, and they're not just playing tank wars. You know, they're not just autoing each other every few seconds, and it's like, oh, it's time to ult to clear the wave. It's nice to see something a little bit more dynamic.
With dirty, dirty farming behind the turret.
That's right.
So it's instead of tank versus tank, it's tank versus minions, and then another tank under the turret.
Huh. The tank kind of feels sad because he wants to go and deal with the other tank, but the other tank is too tanky to be tanked down. Wow.
Someone actually winning that surprised me a bit.
I'm just surprised the amount of split pushing pressure that Duke is already able to put so early in the game. Goon taking a fair amount of poke from Edge's Sand Soldiers.
Yes, he is. And, I mean, watch on that invade, too. I mean, he did have some good wards down, so it wasn't the riskiest thing in the world, but he did get punished for it. Oh.
Whoa, going in on the Goon. There's the Emperor's Divide. It was dodged by the Flash. Chaos Storm doesn't connect, though. Score in a little bit of trouble. And Edge makes it out too, but they are very low health. Teleport coming in.
Here
someday
comes Duke.
They're going to try to catch them. Flash up here to get the knockup. Here comes Peekaboo to come up. Don't even need him, though. A kill for Goong. Edge gets back in the lane, but he's still very low health.
I don't know. Duke might be able to pull off some sort of crazy move right here if he wanted to. Instead, he's just going to push up the mid lane, but that's going to be a dragon over to Najin the Empire.
Yeah, looking pretty good already here in game number two. And someday, you know, didn't ult to try to save anybody. I suppose it was a little bit too dangerous.
Yeah.
Being that far into the enemy jungle.
Yeah. Duke is maxing the burnout here, as we can see. Our observer showing us, just so he has the maximum possible amount of wave clear early in the game.
Makes sense. Well, OQ, they've pushed the lane up, but OQ has started to fall behind pretty significantly in CS already.
Yeah, that's, I mean, Arrow has his ultimate now. He's got the Sheen. He can trade without really many ramifications from OQ because he just pops the Bio Arcane Barrage and then starts mowing him down with Sheen procs. So That is it's going to be really difficult for OQ to get near the wave at this point and reliably farm.
And with Duke pushing through that top lane so quickly, they can't really lane swap him, can they?
No. Someday it might be interesting to try to lane swap him or have OQ go into the 1v1 just because Someday has just the cowl right now, so OQ would be quite strong. Although he doesn't have the Blade of the Ruined King completed yet, and Duke does. This is really problematic for Someday that he... One of the biggest, most annoying things about Shyvana is she does a lot of magic damage to you, but then when she itemizes with Blade of the Ruined King, she does both kinds of damage, and that's why one of the reasons this build is so efficient for Shyvana in a top lane situation, because basically you force the other top laner to get to either out damage you, which is difficult if you're playing a tank, or to get two core items before they can compete with your split pushing in any way, shape, or form.
Yeah, which by then you've lost a turret or two already. Makes it a bit tough. And Najin certainly jumping out to a pretty significant lead early on in this one. OQ's getting pretty close to his blade though. Shouldn't be too much longer.
And what are they going to do about Duke? They have no answer to this split push. And the Shen is just a long way away from getting Trinity Force or anything that's going to give him what he needs to actually take down this Shyvana or match her damage.
Yeah, Score's not really able to put enough pressure on like a 2v2 or something, I suppose. Didn't really work.
Yeah, they just can't right now. I mean, Duke and Watch have built for damage, so any 2v2 in the top side would be very difficult for KT to come out with a victory in. Duke also two levels up now.
Wow.
Oh, that's not good. That's actually probably the worst thing.
It's not something we see very often, too.
Well, Duke's just been all over the map. He was farming out mid lane for a while after that little engagement. He's got to, Someday cannot do that. He has to be so careful.
Yeah.
I miss you, Blade of the Ruined King, split push Shyvana.
It's been fun to watch. Is he going to try to ultimate away from the turret, maybe? Oh, Duke going in. Taking a lot of turret damage, though.
It's okay, he's just going to go heal off the blue buff. Take that, too. This is so reminiscent of last game, where KT was just taking over the jungle with all the pressure. This time, however, Najin just responding in kind. And KT, they keep going into the bottom side of the map. This is where they, have the power, but they can't take away that blue buff right now. Score needs to be taking a serious look around the Dragon Pit because they have to get this next objective.
Oh, they caught Watch in the jungle there. There's a flay. Peekaboo keeps him close by. Flash from Arrow, and there's an ult. Bullseye. The Arrow picks up a kill there. That was a direct hit.
And again, you... That's the side of the jungle that KT actually has control over because they're the ones aggressively pushing up in the bottom lane. So a little bit dangerous for Watch to be there. Had an opportunity just to go into the top side, his top side instead and farm up that way, but gets caught out and he ultimately pays for it. Now, of course, there's not really anything that can be taken.
Oh, nice all in onto Edge. Edge taking a lot of damage from that. Chaos Storm comes back in. Emperor's Vine pushed away and here comes Score over the wall. Can they turn it around? Shen comes in as well. And they pick up the kill. Both mid laners go down, but at least they were able to turn that around on Goong. But man, they used a lot to take out Goong.
Wow, Goong, heads up play, but what are they gonna do? KT, every time Someday leaves his lane, he takes so much damage onto his tower.
Yeah.
So it was a nice play by Goong, and the fact that it was a one for one, they also got 50% damage down onto the bottom turret, or the top turret rather. And that is worth so much.
Man, I really thought that was going to be a pretty quick kill for Goong, but KT just barely managed to turn that one around. A crazy team fight. Or 1v1 that turned into sort of a team fight. Dragon up
a
to 25.
A skirmish,
yes. A melee. Oh, Shen just throws swords at you as you walk by. Here comes Edge, though. Duke has to ult to get away.
And now that ult may not be up for the start of this dragon fight either.
Definitely won't be. the Dragon coming up in about 5 seconds. Get it back pretty quickly, but yeah, be around for the moment.
You could definitely get the Fury back relatively rapidly. Uh-oh,
oh,
nice
they caught OQ. Great descendants. OQ flashes away and gets barely out of range. Pure, though, taking a lot of damage.
Well, good thing they chunked out Najin right before this next Dragon.
Yeah.
That's going to be something that OQ has to just sort of auto-attack the Gromp for just to get some more HP, but I don't think they're going to be able to contest this Dragon at all.
Doesn't look like it right now. Edge coming down as well, too. Peekaboo putting in some nice wards deep in the jungle, and they get that Dragon. So tying things up in Dragons, getting a kill, getting some wards down, which is probably the most important thing, is to have those wards down. Peekaboo's been doing such a good job of being annoying as far as controlling this vision. First game, it was a lot of score. This game, it's been a lot of Peekaboo.
Yep. I mean, Peekaboo did a lot of work in the first game, too, in terms of vision control. You could definitely see he is a very good support player.
Yeah, it's really good to see him back, too, because he was always one of the more exciting, intelligent supports to watch. Good mechanics, good decision-making, great warding. I still don't know if they needed to replace Fixer with him, but he's a good support.
So it's just interesting to me because if you look at the teams that really could have used a support player, you would have thought that Najin would be the more logical choice for Peekaboo.
Could be. He only plays for telecoms. That's the rule.
He won't play if he has to pay a phone bill. Has to get that for free all the time.
That's part of the deal. Free phone and internet. Play, OQ goes into the box. Gets hit, OQ tumbling in. Arrow taking some damage, but there's the exhaust. That's gonna cut quite a bit of it. Score coming over the wall. Oh, and here comes Watch. Chenault coming down as well, too. Teleport's coming in. Can Duke make a play here? Peekaboo gets taken out before he can descendants away. And Najin backing off with the knock-up from Pure. Whoa, Someday coming back in again with the taunt on a Pure. They get the kill via score,
Duke.
But Duke is right here, though. They may be able to turn this one around. Or not. Here comes Goong, a little bit late to the party. Edge comes down as well, too. So two down on both sides. A little bit of an awkward fight there.
Yeah, definitely just a bit awkward. Arrow had his Trinity Force right there. Has a bunch more gold to spend at the moment after picking up a couple kills so far this game. And, you know, the Shen ult was pretty telegraphed, I had to say, onto Peekaboo at the start of that fight. So a bit of a surprise that OQ got hit by the taunt, that he was even within taunt range by the time that channel completed. And it's like Najin not quite going to trade the tower right here. They
good damage from KT.
They're going to get the bottom one, but KT not able to take out the mid turret. That is a pretty significant advantage now for Najin. They're starting to take over in terms of the turret score.
Yeah, 2-0 so far, but that's going to change now. There goes mid lane turret. Oh, and here comes Alistar from the side. Nice Ember's Divide to bring Pure back in. They would have liked to catch more. They'll take a kill to go along with that turret.
And Goon just farming out the bottom side right now. Very strange that he stuck around there for so long after the turret was destroyed just to farm, because he's the main source of wave clear on his team. And without him in mid, this is just going to keep happening.
Yeah, a lot of damage out of that mid lane turret. Will they be able to actually take it out? Looks like they will. So responding with two turrets and a kill now. Duke invading into the enemy jungle. Looks like they're going to trade blues.
Yeah, just a blue trade going down, but importantly, Edge likely to receive the blue buff, whereas Goom left without one on his own. And this is a bit of an interesting situation from Najin. But remember, we're talking about these team comps. KT has extremely strong siege, and Najin only has the Victor for the wave clear. So Goom has to be in the right place. He cannot be split pushing. There is no reason for Victor to continue split pushing after that turret goes down. You have a Blade Shyvana and a Blade Vayne. You have a great 1-3-1, but Victor should just be sitting in the mid lane clearing the wave. That is misuse of this composition. I mean, they get punished really hard for it, and two towers go down.
Yeah, this game's gotten very, very even very quickly. Same turrets, same dragons, similar kills. Gold is very close. Dragging up in about 2 minutes, though. And who's going to have the edge going into that one?
I mean, we'll see how it actually goes down. I I think that Duke's still working on getting a little bit tankier. He's great in the split push right now, but he's still not up to full power in terms of team fighting. Has a cowl, probably going to get a Randuin's Omen next and work from there.
Could have just said KT. They've got the edge going into every fight in this game. Set you up for that one. Looks like KT's going to take another turn in bot lane, though. Najin kind of appearing to fall apart a little bit at this point in the game. They look a bit flustered.
Well, they don't have wave clear, so as long as this Kog'Maw has this Trinity Force and is able to push up, there's not a lot they can do unless Goog runs around the map to put out the fires, which he's not going to do, apparently.
I guess so. That turret getting lower as well, too. Goon coming in now, but that turret's going to go down before he gets there. And KT just walks up and kills another two turrets.
Well, I mean, this is how it's going to go once you hit this power spike. And KT does have a good comp as long as they can continue to control the tempo of the game. Hmm. If they can get the siege, they're going to be in really good shape. If they can sit at the dragon and force Najin to engage into them where they can kite, they're going to be in good shape. The problem for KT's composition arrives if you get behind and you have to be the one engaging onto a Baron or trying to force a fight around an objective. That's when you don't have any tools to do so besides like landing a hook or a crazy Azir engage, but that Azir engage leaves your Kog'Maw very vulnerable.
Najin doing the best they can to push the lanes back up after losing those two turrets. Dragon is up now. And it looks like KT is going to be able to get there first.
I love the fact that KT is just figuring out whichever lane OQ is in and then just putting a bunch of people there to kill towers because they know he doesn't even have a static shiv yet. Now he has it just completed. But up until this point, there was really nothing to prevent them from taking a turret with a Zir and a Trinity Force Kog'Maw. It's very simple.
KT already working on that dragon. Looks like they'll be able to get it without any issue. Najin pushing up the mid lane, but KT should be able to get back to defend it. And they do.
Yeah, pretty easy. They have the mobility. Duke, nice zone on the side, and we do indeed see his Banshee's Veil, and now he started working out a Randuin's Omen, so he is getting very scary for Kog'Maw.
KT able to clear those minions really quickly, and they've still only taken about a third damage on that turret.
There is no damage on the top lane tower 24 minutes into this game. Duke has been doing so well on the top side of the map.
It is pretty impressive. So now I'd imagine we'll see KT going top then. Got to continue that siege, right?
Well, they've taken down two tier twos already. So yeah, that is the only kind of, uh-oh.
Oh boy, Duke gets caught. Here comes Score over the wall. They got him with the, wow. They got him with all the CC.
What a good, good hook from Peekaboo. On the setup, waiting for the dragon transform, immediately continues the CC chain.
Yep.
And locks up the kill onto Duke.
Well, Edge can hold this turret too just fine, it looks like. In fact, he's going to Empress by Duke. Goon back under the turret. What a play by Edge. Barely gets out, barely lives. But still, talk about defending your turret.
Chen ulting right there. Also, Arrow just left a split push at the top side of the map.
Why not? Oh, we may have a fight. Here's a headbutt pure flashing in for the pulverize. Edge flashing back in the meantime. OQ very low already, but here comes Watch with a nice flank. Pick move from the side, throws down the shield to try to protect Edge. Doesn't end up working though. Kills coming in from both sides so far. Goon getting very low. Knockups coming in, and Watch trying to throw out those hate spikes as well as he can. Ultimate tank fight!
Well,
goodbye, Watch.
Duke not actually going to TP right there.
I guess
he
not.
He had an opportunity to come into that fight.
Whoa, pure gets caught too, and KT. Near ace for them.
Kind of a delayed ace. Duke was dead until recently. And
that's
here we
true.
Go. Void Rush.
Well, they're going to go right back up there to keep Arrow safe so they can keep pushing this turret.
I have to wonder why Duke wasn't going to TP into that fight because everyone was so low.
Yeah.
And he's got a lot of items now. I feel that he actually could have cleaned up that engagement pretty easily.
It is really puzzling.
As you know, he's dead right now, but starting right now, he could have actually TP'd to a ward. They had that pink ward. Of course, OQ is already dead. But Goog's still alive and dancing around the gravity field at the moment.
So
it's a 3v3.
He would have been in, like, right now. I don't know.
I mean, Arrow was just nowhere even close to that engagement, so they could have had a 3v4 with the Blade of the Ruined King, Shyvana, who's going to do exceptionally well in those skirmishes. Peekaboo.
Peekaboo is so good.
Having a great game.
Oh, yeah. Having two great games. Well, solid lead for KT at this point. And now do you start to pressure Baron? Maybe you give up this mid lane turret. Looks like they're thinking about it. Or not.
Nope. They're with the Azir and score from the side. So KT back in this game. It looked like they were having some rough times early, but some days managed to make it work, even though he's fallen incredibly far behind in terms of farm.
Yeah, he certainly made up for it, though, in kills and assists. He's been able to be a part of quite a bit. Peekaboo's getting pretty scary as well, too, as far as his ability to just sit in a fight. He's already got a frozen heart.
That's actually ridiculous.
I know.
It's great.
1,400 more gold than pure.
It's great because Someday built Tyranduin's Omen, so now your support is not going to be as easily targetable by Duke or by OQ.
Yep.
No, KT looking good as long as they can be the ones who continue to pressure here, which is definitely pretty easy for them.
Seems like they're still balancing on a bit of an edge, but they're balancing on the right side so far.
Yeah, Edge really, as a player, coming out much better than last week, too.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, on Saturday, he was just, he had some very unfortunate and kind of mindless deaths where he would score, would come into the mid lane, get a gank for him, get that kill, and then he would get low, and then he would walk away, not even back to his turret, start recalling, and the enemy jungle would just pop out and kill him.
Yep.
So, can't give away kills like that. Was pretty sloppy.
That's a pretty easy thing to fix, though, and it looks like he has. And his Azir looking miles better than his Victor did. And most of the other times we've seen it.
His Victor was pretty good last game.
Last game it was, but before that, though, his Victors were not terribly great. Today in general, looking better.
Yeah. Much tighter play.
Oh, they're going to pressure this mid lane. They think they've got Najin out of position here, and they might be able to just grab an inhibitor turret for this. They will. Wow. Now, can Najin respond? KT on the run. Shen able to come in. Shyvana trying to come from the side, but he's going to be held up by that Azir turret.
That was a really awkward teleport. And KT definitely making the most of that, going through the bottom side jungler, not even giving.
Oh, wow. They're rushing Baron. Are they actually
way too many?
No.
No, there are way too many KT wards around that Baron right now. They can't feasibly start. The best thing they can do is try and bait this. I doubt that's going to work where there's a Rek'Sai in the AT. Now they're going to start it, though. They're seen 100%.
Okay. Well, here we go, Baron. At about half health now. What's the engage going to be from KT? Alistar trying to zone people out. Baron getting very low. People coming in. Peekaboo getting close. Lays down the box to make it hard and score. Able to get that Baron. Can KT win the rest of this fight? Now it looks like they can. Huge engage. OQ gets jumped on by Someday over the wall. Someday trying to tumble away. Amazing. KT steals the Baron, gets four kills. They may get close to ending this one right now.
Yeah, the death timers are pretty long. I actually think they may be able just to win the game. They have the minion wave right there with them, and they have the Trinity Force Kog'Maw.
Wow,
so,
score. What a hero.
Yeah, that was a big, big steal. But Najin, an absolute desperation Baron call, totally unnecessary.
I like this by KT, too, playing it safe, just knowing that they can take two inhibitors instead of just try to go for the win here. Makes you wonder if they could have just gone for the win there. But either way, it's a nice big, big edge now.
Well, they got such a huge gold lead out of that fight. Definitely the safer thing is go back, spend your money, then make the final push. Just look at that. They have 2,000 gold on four members.
Yeah. Take the dragon on your way out as well, too. Get that move speed boost.
I was laughing during that fight because Someday totally whiffed his taunt.
Oh.
On to OQ. But it's okay. still a good effort. I mean, OQ has a QSS now, but he's a long way away from getting any kind of armor penetration. Look at that hook from Pure, again, on the Alistair headbutt.
Peekaboo, yeah.
On to Pure, and then there's the steal.
Pulls Duke back.
Yep. I mean, Peekaboo is doing amazing work this game.
Yeah. He has certainly not missed a beat after being gone for a little while.
I don't know why someday taunted backwards right there. Looked like a misclick.
He's scared, you know? Scared of OQ. He's a scary guy. That's scary vein. Well, 0-3-2, not too scary, though.
This scary vein has no armor penetration, and he has a Sunfire and a Randuin. So Vayne is scary, but, you know, maybe not. In
Giant
this particular
Shen is coming. So Duke just, like, stunned. He's like, wow, I wasn't ready for Giant Shen. Just in case Shen couldn't be any more obvious, now he's, like, 10 feet tall.
I like how Sumnay just left him there and just kept farming the minions while Duke stood there after his Banshee's Veil was blown and his recall was stopped.
That was like a moment where the top laners look at each other and like, so, we've reached this point, have we? All right, putting down the pink ward to make sure there's no flanks from Watch. I don't think they need to be too worried either way. Here comes a push. I want to take that last inhibitor. And have they caught Duke? Oh, if that hook had hit, would have been bad for Duke.
Oh. Score just trying to prevent Duke from recalling right now and actually mounting any kind of defense in the base. They want those super minions on the Nyx. It's actually very good use of Score's time.
Yeah. Well, here come all the super minion waves now. That inhibitor in top lane vulnerable. Score's going to turn around. Evelyn Ult comes in. Pikmu drops that box immediately, misses his hook. And Duke gets very low, goes down. Edge doing a ton of damage with those Sand Soldiers in the middle. Goong has to run for his life out of this fight. OQ has a pretty good angle on things, though, but he's not able to get a lot of damage done yet. Waiting for it. Here comes Edge. They're going to flash ahead. Tried to get that taunt. Didn't end up working out. OQ tumbling back to the base after getting out with that QSS, popping his summoner heals. Well, the KT's got enough. They're just going to go for these Nexus turrets. One is already down. Two goes down. Less than a week ago, Najin got the 2-0.
That was a sick Azir play. He bent the soldiers around the Nexus right there for the ultimate. Now we know why Najin was so dedicated to banning out that Azir.
Less than a week ago, Najin was on the winning end of a 2-0. This time, KT comes right back with a very strong 2-0 to start off their second round.
Yeah, very methodical play overall. Najin started out doing so well in that second game, but then when the siege actually kicked in, they had nothing to really stop it, and that created a large gold lead.
One thing that really struck me was just how well Peekaboo and Score seemed to work together in terms of controlling vision, in terms of like making picks.
Yes.
I think this is a duo that could actually really, really work for KT.
Well, we'll see. You know, Edge's performance was good today, but has been a bit spotty. I'm excited to see the new KT, obviously. Peekaboo doing a lot of work on his first day back after a while with those wrist injuries.